tonight.
Someone waits for me.
There's the Chatham Marfiner welcoming you to the Bing Crosby Show, presented by Chesterfield, produced and transcribed in San Francisco. With John Scott Trotter and his orchestra, Judd Collins are the mayors and Bing's guests. Dennis Crosby and Philip Crosby.
Oh, the twins. Some guests, huh?
Well, I think it's very nice on our March 15th broadcast if you could have two little dependents with you, don't you?
There's more, you know.
Yes, I know. Bing, you've had your brother Bob on the show a couple of times.
Uh-huh.
Your niece, Kathy Crosby.
Yeah, very good.
Gary, your oldest boy.
Mm-hmm.
And now the twins. What are you going to do for guests when you run out of Crosbys?
That is impossible.
Woods are full of them.
Scratching the surface. Ken, the Crosbys come in flocks and swarms like locusts, the Japanese beetle, grasshoppers, the tsetse fly, or the saber-toothed titmouse. They just abound.
The saber-toothed titmouse.
Oh, very lethal animal.
There's a plague of Crosbys.
We are definitely a blight. Life on the American scene. And sad part is, Ken, that up to now, we have baffled science.
Nobody's come up with the Crosby cure, huh?
Nope.
I'm sure some scientist will think of something.
Carp, in saying that, I'm positive that you've brought a message of hope to scores of long-suffering humans.
Say, by the way, Bing, I want to ask you about your brother, Everett.
Science gave up on him.
I didn't mean it. What I meant was, how come you've never had your brother, Everett, as a guest on the show?
Saving him. For television.
Oh, is Everett visual?
Oh, yeah, he's a sight. Ken, it's time now for the opening number, which happens to be Copper Canyon, written by Livingston and Evans. This is from the Paramount picture, Copper Canyon. And if the Rhythmers and John Scott are ready, I guess I'm all set to head up for the canyon my own self. I'm up to my neck, being down in the mountains, there's a place I can play. So to lose my hankering, I pull my anchor in and head that away. Dee-de-la-dee-de-low, hear the fiddle and bow, and swing your cares away. Down in Copper Canyon, people are mighty gay. Look at her, look at him, look at Sally and Slim. Why, they're so glad they came. And in Copper Canyon, I'm sure I'm feeling the same. I'm gonna dance with a girly romance, with a girly, the one in the prettiest gown. Have a wing-ding, have a time. It's that kind of town. Dee-de-la-dee-de-low, keep a tapping your toe and give a yip-yahoo. 'Cause in Copper Canyon, there ain't nothing else to do.
Gonna dance with the fellas, romance with the fellas, whirl in a prettiest gown.
Have a wing-ding, have a time. It's that kind of time.
Dee-de-la-dee-de-low, keep a-tapping your toe and give a yip-yahoo. 'Cause in Copper Canyon, there ain't nothing else to do. But have a hoedown, let the cider go down, whoop and holler, never gonna slow down.
Gals in gingham, but you gonna bring 'em, gingham, if you wanna swing 'em.
Down in Copper Canyon, there ain't nothing else, don't want nothing else, ain't got nothing else to do. Down in Copper Canyon. Friends, we want to explain how every one of you can judge for yourself which cigarette is milder. Now, all you have to do is make the same test that all tobacco farmers make
to judge which of their tobaccos is mild. Yes, be your own cigarette expert. It's as simple as ABC.
A, buy a pack of Chesterfields and open the top all the way. B, smell the pleasantly mild aroma that comes from that Chesterfield pack. C, compare that milder Chesterfield aroma with what you get from any other brand.
As soon as you do, you'll find that Chesterfields do have a milder aroma. And then when you light up, you'll find that Chesterfields smoke milder.
That's because tobaccos that smell milder smoke milder. You see, that milder Chesterfield aroma comes from the right combination of the world's best tobaccos. No other cigarette has it, only Chesterfield. What goes into a cigarette is what you get out of it. And into every Chesterfield, we put mild, ripe, properly aged tobaccos.
So out of every Chesterfield, you get a cooler, better-tasting smoke, a much milder smoke.
So be your own cigarette expert.
Yes, friends, make this test yourself. Buy Chesterfields today and enjoy more smoking pleasure than any other cigarette can give you. Always buy Chesterfields.
Chesterfields satisfy women and men. Chesterfields over and over again. Milder, much milder, all smokers agree. Always buy Chesterfield's ABC.
Paramount Studios, where I've been stealing money for about 19 years, is planning a big party down at Front Royal, Virginia, on April 1st. Seems they're going to have a big premiere of a new picture titled Riding High, which I am somewhat involved. Here's Sunshine Cake, one of the bright tunes from the Riding High.
We're going to make a sunshine cake. It's everything nice. It's sugar and spice. It's a cinch.
We ought to bake us a sunshine cake. It does more good than a big thick steak.
Well, start.
Start with a tablespoon of trouble.
Then
add
a smile and let it bubble up.
We ought to bake a sunshine cake. It really isn't so hard to make. Fresh tears, a pound or two of pleasure.
You needn't use a measure cup.
Any questions, ladies?
Then we proceed. Well, it's not a love recipe, and you don't have to be a good cook.
Or run to the oven and look
for such a simple dish. All you do is wish.
So why not bake a sunshine cake?
Of course, it may keep your dreams away.
But friends say there's nothing like the flavor.
Don't wait to do your friends a favor. And for goodness sake,
but what are we waiting for?
Let's bake the sunshine cake.
It's got vitamins A.
Vitamins B.
Vitamins. L-O-V-E.
If you're fat, it's for that.
If you're thin, pack it in.
What's wrong if you get a double grin? We'd ought to bake a sunshine cake.
Of course, it may keep your dreams away.
Of course,
friends say there's nothing like the flavor.
Friends say there's nothing like the flavor. Don't
for goodness sake,
do your friends a favor. Don't goodness sake, do your friends a favor.
Then for goodness sake,
what are we waiting for? Let's bake the sunshine cake.
Well, sir, looks like it's old family night here once again. For as announced earlier, we got double trouble with us this evening. Sort of fill the guest spot. These two buckaroos have been kicking around the Crosby Corral ever since the stork held a 1 cent sale at our diggings some 14 years ago. Here now are two well-scrubbed but pretty uncomfortable young men. Dennis and Philip Crosby.
Thanks, Dad.
Thanks.
Well, sir, I must say, I've got to tell you this. Hurts me, but I've got to tell you that you look real flashy tonight. Very debonair.
We owe it all to soap and water.
Congratulations. I'm glad the four of you finally got together.
He used the soap, and I used the water.
And now, wait, what's this? As far as a cursory scrutiny indicates, you're very sharp, though. You're really dressed to the teeth. Incidentally, did you brush them?
You ought to know. You fell on toothbrushes, and they were wet.
I also know it's very easy to wet a toothbrush without brushing your teeth.
True, but it sure fools the average toothbrush feeler.
I gotta tell you something, son. You ain't ever gonna fool me, because from now on, I'm gonna mark X's on your teeth with black crayons.
Very sporty. Two-tone teeth.
Now, if you could only get black and white shoes to match.
Black and white shoes? That'd make it real flashy. I'll tell you what I'll do for you. I may pull off my Hickok and give each of you a little belt in the back.
Now, Dad, remember what happened the last time you got mad at us and pulled off your belt in the race?
Never mind. That was no laughing matter.
It sure got a laugh out of us.
Just settle down. Now, just take a beat. May I ask you something, Dennis? Why aren't your shoes down there?
No time. Still use the brush for half an hour.
I found that shoe polish is just about the best thing in the world to keep your hair on.
He's a real dude, isn't he, Dad?
Anybody with hair is a dude, I think.
None of that dude stuff for me.
No, why?
I'm a muscle man.
Oh, a muscle man. Get this, yeah, you're a regular Samson with Delilah's figure.
If you ask me, that's a pretty good arrangement.
Yeah, now. Who asked you? Nimbly avoiding any further discussion along this line, tell me, what have you kids been doing lately outside of schoolwork and playing basketball?
Well, we've been pretty busy lately.
We're working on a big deal.
Yeah? What big deal is this?
We're organizing a Gary Crosby fan club.
Well, Gary Crosby fan club. Well, I think that's nice. That's very brotherly.
Would you like to join?
Would
you like to join?
Well, yes. Yes, I guess I would.
Thank you. That'll be $25.
Here's your receipt.
Just a minute. Wait a minute. Time here. $25 to join Gary's fan club? That's a pretty big bite, boys. How many members you got?
So far, only Gary.
Oh, he went for it, huh?
Well, you know, Dad, he's a joiner.
He's a joiner. Well, I tell you, tell me this. Now, let's say I pop for $25. What do I get?
You get a certificate, a celluloid button, and a lock of Gary's hair.
Nice. That's a very personal touch.
You ought to see the keen buttons we got for Gary's fan club, Dad.
Yeah, we got a real bargain on them. They're surplus.
On the buttons? Well, what do you mean, surplus?
All we had to do was print Gary's name on them. They turned out fine.
Yeah? What'd they say?
Gary Dewey for president.
You know, he might make it. They haven't come up with anybody else so far. But getting back to that $25 fee now, I'd like to go into just a little accounting. Just let's have an audit. How much do these buttons cost you, fellas?
3 cents a piece. And the certificates cost us about 7 cents.
All right, that's 10 cents. Now, what becomes of the other $24.90?
That's to cover the cost of mailing.
All right, I'll join the fan club. But because of the fact that you won't have to mail the stuff to me, you see, we live in the same place. I wouldn't be at all surprised if I should get in for, say, 25 cents.
Uh-oh. Trouble.
That a deal?
Well, we're pretty bad businessmen, Dad. So we'll accept your offer.
Well, I'm glad. And I want to compliment you on starting this fan club for Gary. It's very nice. Don't you think it would also be a nice gesture if you started one for your dad, too?
Hmm? Don't worry. We're going to take care of you, Dad.
Yes. Gary's fan club is bound to get too big, and we'll be very happy to throw the overflow your way.
Throwing my way, huh? I'd make a picture. Well, that's sweet. But, fellas, while we're on matters financial, I want to tell you that Gary got paid $25 for appearing on this program. Did you know that? What do you boys think you're worth?
We'd better not discuss that.
Matters of that sort are handled by our agent, D.L. Crosby.
D.L. Crosby?
Yes, Dixie Lee Crosby.
Is your mother your agent?
Yes, and she's good.
You ought to get Mom for your agent instead of Uncle Everett.
You think so, huh?
Sure. That way you might end up with something at the end of the year.
Well, seems to be a schism developing here in the crowd. You know something? You sold me, though. You boys have something you'd like to sing for the folks tonight? A little ditty you could warble?
Phil's got a number he'd like to do. Kind of a surprise for you.
I thought I might sing a song of yesteryear.
Oh, you did. Yesteryear. Oh, well, why don't you step right up to the mic? I'm taking an awful chance here, but I'll go ahead. Take us back, son. Dennis, you want to make a little announcement here? Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Philip Crosby will sing Thanks, which is made famous by our agent's husband.
Give him a little arpeggio.
Oh, thanks for all the lovely delight I found in your embrace.
You're not suffering enough. Suffer a little.
I'm thankful, though I know it's ending all too soon. And thanks for unforgettable nights I never can replace, and memories that linger like a haunting tune. It is better to have loved you, dear, and lost.
You're in pain.
Than never to have loved at all. It is better, for no matter what the cause, I held the world in sway, an emperor for a day. And thanks for taking me on the road to paradise. We lost our way, but still I must convey my thanks.
Great, good. Thanks, Phil. Phil, that was fine. The best imitation of Jerry Colonna I've heard this year. But actually, I think I have a vague idea of what you were driving at. I really do.
That was okay, Dad, but people just don't sing that way anymore.
You're telling me. What are they singing like? What do you got to do?
Today you got to blast a song.
Blast a song? Yeah? What's that? I don't know if I'm blasting. What do you do?
It's got to be a Ghost Riders or Mules or Birds or something.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Deems Taylor. What would you care to illustrate? Give us a little rundown on what you think the current trend is, but get in front of the mic or you'll be in Ashtabula, Ohio.
I think the big thing today is a song like this. My heart knows what the wild goose knows, and I must go where the wild goose goes. Wild goose, brother goose, which is best? A wandering foot or a heart at rest? Let it fly, let it fly, let it fly away.
Thank you, Frankie Lane. You were never in better shape. Unless you know what you ought to do, though, while you're here, you ought to stand up and try and sing something legitimate. We got an arrangement, a couple of things here for you. What could you do, Phil?
Well, we had a rather ragged rehearsal on Bibbidi Bobbidi Boo.
Dad'll understand that.
What do you mean, the ragged rehearsal or Bibbidi Bobbidi Boo? Well, let's have it, huh? Let's have the song. You get over here, Phil. Get a good dead aim. You can shut out.
Bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi Salagadoola means Mishigaboolaroo. But the thingamabob that does the job is bibbidi-boppity-boo. Salagadoola, Mishigaboola, bibbidi-boppity-boo. Put them together and what have you got? Bibbidi-boppity-boo.
Bibbidi.
Oh, bibbidi.
Salagadoola, Mishigaboola, bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Oh,
bibbidi.
Put them together and what have you got? Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Oh, bibbidi.
Salagadoola, Mishigaboola, bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Oh, bibbidi.
It'll do magic, believe it or not. Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Salagadoola means Mishigaboolaroo. But the thingamabob that does the job is bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Salagadoola, Mishigaboola, bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. Put them together and what have you got? Bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-bibbidi-bobbidi-boo. Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Thanks, boys. That was fine. Fine. Take five now while I do a favorite of some years ago. It's being revived quite a bit right now. Mr. P. Lafayette Budkin on the guitar. from New Richmond, Indiana. Oh, that's so pretty. Look at it again.
Martha. Rambling rose of the wildwood, Martha, with your fragrance divine, rosebud of the days of my childhood, watched you bloom in the wild. And I hope to be mine. Martha, now your eyes beam at twilight, sparkling like each dewdrop at dawn. Martha, when I look for your love light, I awake with a sigh, and I find you are gone. Martha, when I look for your love light, I awake with a sigh, and I find you are gone. Thank
you. Thank you very much. Folks, there's a guy called Como, a character named Godfrey, who talked to you about Chesterfields. And, of course, Ken and I, we bat the word about them back and forth every week, as you know. But we're not the only ones who can tell you about them. No, sir. Millions of folks will speak up for Chesterfields, including the top stars of Hollywood. Yes, sir. The Hollywood stars smoke Chesterfields. William Holden, for example. Now, what was it he told us, Ken?
Well, being Bill Holden said, Chesterfields have a wonderful aroma, and they give me a milder smoke, a much milder smoke. And even more than that, they leave a clean, fresh taste in my mouth after smoking.
Smart boy, that Holden. By the way, Ken, what's Bill's latest picture?
It's Paramount picture, titled Dear Wife. Bing, it's all about Newlyweds. Stars Bill Holden, Joan Caulfield, Mona Freeman, and Billy DeWolf.
Well, with a combination like that, no wonder folks are saying that Dear Wife is the funniest thing they've seen in years. But getting back to Chesterfields, Ken, what Bill Holden says about them is what millions of folks say about them.
Chesterfields taste better, and they leave a clean, fresh taste after smoking. Yes, friends, everything you want in a cigarette you'll find in a Chesterfield. Always buy Chesterfield, the best cigarette for you to smoke.
Walt Disney's Technicolor picture Cinderella is just packed with good tunes. Here's the ballad. Nice arrangement, John. Well, that about gets it for tonight. But before I leave, I want to tender my profound thanks to Master Dennis, Master Philip Crosby, for hooking it up with their pappy here tonight.
Say, Dad, who's going to be with you next week?
You know something, Dennis? I have absolutely no idea who our guest is. Nobody tells me.
Well, that certainly is a fine way to run a big show like this.
No criticism, please. Just wash up, get your money, and I'll call you. Don't call me. See you next week for Chesterfield, folks. That's the best cigarette for you to smoke.
The Bing Crosby Show, presented by Chesterfield, was produced and transcribed in San Francisco by Bill Morrow and Myrtle McKenzie. Incidentally, I just got a late flash on our guests for next week, folks. With us will be Mr. Clifton Webb and an old friend of Bing's from the Paul Whiteman days, a very fine singer, Miss Mildred Bailey. Folks, as you all know, this is Red Cross Fund time. The theme for this 1950 campaign is All May Help Through the Red Cross. That means that everyone, through their contribution, may help a neighbor in need. But when your Red Cross uses the word neighbor, it's not just talking about those people next door or down the block, but people across the nation in all walks of life. Because to the Red Cross, a neighbor is not defined by distances and boundaries, but by the sympathy and understanding of people everywhere. And that's an idea that brings everyone together in a friendly spirit, no matter who they may be. And it's an idea, too, that gives everyone a chance to help. That's right, giving to the Red Cross means that not just a few of us, or even a great many of us, but everybody can help. So let's all give now through the Red Cross 1950 Fund. The George Burns and Gracie Allen Show follows immediately.